What I'm going to talk about today is really not only about advertising and promotion, but the challenges that the industry is facing and what can be done about it. For me, this thought process started about 8 years back when I was one of the speakers at the Minds to Market, and I had made a presentation which was called Shift Happens. Some of you may have heard about it, and I'm going to begin today with a clip from that. I'm not going to go through the whole thing because it's pretty long, but I'm going to begin with a short clip from that presentation. So as you can see, this was in 2007 and India was on a roll. Everything great that could happen to the gem and jewelry industry was happening in India. And we had strengths at that time. We were still very ethical, both as far as product is concerned, as far as certification is concerned, and as far as commitment to the industry is concerned. We were financially strong and we had the integrity that was required to carry the business through. We were advertising and promoting. Well, it was not us, it was mainly De Beers and DTC who was promoting and advertising at that time. But there was enough advertising and promotion for the industry as a category going on for the consumers to come and keep buying. And we knew and we understood the target audience. Again, mainly because of research, market research that was done by these miners who kept sharing that information with us. But at the end of the day, we were very much in control of what we were all doing. And we had everything going for us. And therefore, all of us had a dream. We had dared to dream in spite of trying circumstances. 2007, 2008, we all know, did become a challenging period. But in spite of that, we had our dream in place. And our dream was So the dream was that we would restore its former glory to the gem and jewelry industry. All of us had the dream. I was very serious about the dream. But unfortunately, and it's not a coincidence, the 2015 was from the original presentation. It was not something that I changed for today's presentation. And we are sitting here in 2015, and we all know that the dream was short-lived. Our dream has been shattered. The situation in which the industry is today, there are people who are actively thinking of what else can they do. And that's not a very good sign for an industry. This industry has been there all its life. Ever since women was there, they wanted to adorn themselves. When they had no gold, no diamonds, they were adorning themselves with the teeth of a lion or the teeth of a claw of a tiger or stones if nothing else was available. Okay, so its jewelry is not something that can or should ever fade away. And women will always want jewelry. So if we don't do things right, somebody else is going to step into the place. You might have high-tech jewelry tomorrow. You might have phones hanging around women's necks. There's various things that can happen. But that's not something that we should be looking at. And therefore, we need to look at why this dream shattered. Why is it that people are not interested in jewelry anymore? And what is the reason? The real reason is that inadvertently, we have managed to take every one of the strengths and kill them. Every one of the strengths I mentioned earlier are today actually weaknesses as far as our industry is concerned. And I'm going to take a look at some of those challenges and weaknesses and see whether we are today through unity. Because if you don't act as a community, nothing is going to happen. It's not a one-man job to change the industry or to change how people work and think within the industry. So we're going to look at each of them. So it's the same slide repeated, only the pictures change, where for ethics now I have money which is outweighing ethics, okay, which is I think really a fact of life today. Financial institutions are coming and telling us stop, so we are having financial challenges. Advertisement is practically zilch ever since the Godfather walked out of the cabin, and we don't know and understand our target audience anymore. So why did they become weaknesses? And to look at it, when we come to product, the biggest topic of debate today is CVD. Okay, everybody is worried about CVD. But let us accept one thing. CVD is here to stay. By getting worried about it, it's not going to solve any of your problems. The only way to solve it is to make sure that you treat it as a separate product. By trying to mix it within your existing diamonds, you are doing nothing except ruining what is actually probably 99.8% of your product. I don't think CVD production today would be more than 0.2% of the entire inventory that we hold in diamonds. For 0.2% and a short-term gain, if we are willing to destroy the 99.8% by mixing it, I think we all need to sit back and look whether we want to be in the industry or not. Okay? So I think we have to keep them separate, and that is the biggest concern. It's not CVD that is the biggest concern for us. The fact that we are mixing it, the fact that we are not being honest about the two products is what is the biggest concern. When it comes to product, I think there is very limited innovation. Most often I hear that, yeah, because the customer doesn't want it. And every time anybody tells me that, I tell them what Steve Jobs said, that how can I go and do a market research on the iPhone when the customer doesn't even know that that kind of a thing can happen? If you are not going to create different product, if you are not going to give the customer something new to look at and think of, then there is no way in which the customer is ever going to come and tell you that I want this. Because the customer does not have the kind of imagination that we as businessmen, we as designers, we as people in the industry who are offering product should be having. We have got to train ourselves to make sure that we do create product that is innovative all the time. Okay? And what happens when you innovate? The first thing you're doing is you're wiping away the competitor. And you have the advantage of the first. We all know after Apple, every single company except Nokia, who doesn't exist anymore, did copy the systems, the concept and make things which are cheaper. But even then, today, it is Apple that is still the king of the smartphone space. So an innovator is never going to fade away, no matter how many people copy him. Okay, and that's true of industry. Everybody in our industry is constantly worried, if I put my product on the net, people will copy it. Let them copy it. As long as you are constantly innovating, as long as you are constantly coming up with new product, new offerings for the customer, I don't think that is a challenge at all. And innovation will always help you to increase your margins. Your price factor comes in when you have a product that can be compared to the product in the next shop. But once you have a product that is distinctly unique, there are not going to be any comparison. I know people today who are selling diamond studded jewelry at maybe what, 500 rupees a gram? And at the same time, I know people today who are selling it at 2000 rupees a gram, which is probably the price of gold. Or in today's case, maybe more higher than the price of gold. So innovation always has a place. Design innovation especially is very, very important. Category innovation is also important, but that may be a little tougher to implement. But design innovation definitely is not a challenge. So we need to innovate as far as product is concerned. And then the way you present your product. Look at the picture on the left. I have seen so many shops that literally just do this. And look at the picture on the right. You're going to stop and look at the product. You need to entice the customer. You need to make sure that the customer is stepping into your shop, into your booth, if you are a B2B customer, to come and look at your product. So you have to make good displays. The displays should have a theme. They should, as far as possible, the theme should go in with the story behind your collection, and you have to have props that will match that. Certification is our next big challenge. And the biggest challenge that I was hearing about till maybe a month back was over certification. But thanks to GIA, who have suspended what, five diamond people for forging certificates, I would call it. What do you call it?
No, it's not forging. They send the same stones again, so they obtained more than one certificate for the same.
But they must be using it to forge it onto some other stone, I'm assuming. Anyway, give them the benefit of doubt. But these unethical practices are what is the curse of the industry. Today, these practices are even known to the consumers. The world has become a smaller place today. What with internet, what with everything finding on the net. Consumer today knows if these things are happening. And once they know these things are happening, the consumer doesn't know as much detail as we do sitting here. Okay, so if they don't know as much detail, if they just read that CVD is mixed with polished, they don't know it's 0.2% or 0.5% or 20%, but they are worried from that time onwards. And it's the same with certification. People are going to stop trusting certificates. Then where do we go? It's our business. We need to protect our business. Commitment. At one time, when I joined the industry 27 years back, I heard the word muzzle for the first time. Okay? And I asked somebody, I said, what does it mean? He says, this is more than any agreement you would see on a 1,000 rupee stamp paper. Okay, this was 27 years back, and a 1,000 rupee stamp paper at that time would have been a crazy thing. Okay, and today, there are no commitments. I had the opportunity to go to the BDB a few days back, and I was walking down to one of the offices, and I saw somebody who had put a poster outside is saying that if CVD is mixed in this product, we will not return the product, nor will we pay you for the product. Whom are you going to trust on? You can't trust your broker, you can't trust your supplier, you can't trust anybody. Whom are you going to trust? And how does any business, forget the diamond business, which has always thrived on trust, but how does any business be able to perform, be able to carry on itself, if there is no trust element involved? So you have to be careful about that. Financial integrity. Every time I'm talking to people, and I have been one of the guys who has also been saying that, is that by 31st December 2016, we probably have 10,000 crores of rupees less in the industry. There will be so many people who will go bankrupt, who will be willful defaulters, who will have not pay people the money, whatever it is. Okay? And we've seen in the past, what, I think 3 months we probably have lost about 2,000 crores of rupees. Is that right, Sanjay Bhai?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the situation. There is no financial integrity. And the two biggest challenges, money laundering and diversion of funds. I think diversion of funds is the biggest. And that's why I put that picture there, which says bricks and bullion. Money that was supposed to be used for diamonds, used to promote the trade, used to do your business, has all gone into bullion and bricks. In fact, I hope it's not true, but yesterday while I was walking the show, I met some guy and he tells me, do you know that at the end of the show, one bullion dealer is going to go away because he has hedged too much? So, is that his business? No. Is that the money that was taken from the bank for hedging? No. And what happens at the end of the day? Lose money. A lot of people lost money in real estate. I know some people who have lost lots of money and they're not paying the banks back. The money was taken for the diamond business. It was diverted to property. Now he can't get out of it. So what does the bank say? Your industry is bad. So that's why the financial institutes have put their hand up saying no more. We're not going to give you any more money. And our industry can't run without money. You are in high value product. You need a lot of working capital. Your cycles are long. Maybe we've set it up, but the credit terms are long. So finance is an integral and important part of it. And if you're going to divert funds to other industries for short-term gains, going to get us nowhere. Advertising and promotion. As I just said a few minutes back, De Beers, once they were not holding the lion's share of the rough that was being sold in the world, when their rough, these things dropped from, I think, about 80 or 85% to about 30% today, they stopped advertising the way they used to. And once you stop advertising, nobody knows. And why do you have to keep advertising? Let's look at it like this. Who are the jewelry buyers today? They're actually mainly the baby boomers. By baby boomers, I mean people who are 45 plus today. Are there any millennials who walk into the store to buy? No. Is there a reason for it? Yes. The reason is very simple. The baby boomers had seen a period where De Beers was constantly advertising, and therefore jewelry as a category had been etched into their minds. There was a top of mind recall for jewelry because the people in that age group had seen a period where what De Beers used to spend about 100, 150 million a year on advertising, 200 million, 200 million a year on advertising and promoting jewelry. Now that has stopped, the millennials have not seen it. And therefore, the millennials today are not coming to buy jewelry. Now imagine 10 years later when the Gen Z is going to actually be the ones who are going to have the purchasing power. They know nothing about jewelry. They know everything about phones. They know everything about holidays. They know everything about cars. They know everything about clothes. They don't know anything about jewelry. Why? Because you are not informing them. And it's very simple. If the customer does not know, if your target audience does not know, your activity is useless. And as you see on the other side, if I wink at a girl in a dark room, she doesn't see I'm winking. And then if I wonder why she's not responding to my advances, she's never going to respond. You got to wink at her when there is light. She has to be able to see that you're winking. So you need to go out there, shout and say, this is my product, and come, you need it. So advertising and promotion is something that is of critical importance. I always hear that, okay, the industry margins are so small that we cannot afford to advertise. I'm coming to that a little later. But I think that's a very, very lame excuse. That's not an excuse I would even like to think about. And then know and understand your target audience. As I said, we are not innovating in product, and therefore you go from one shop to the other, you are seeing the same product. Some may be fancy, they make only one of a kind, some may be... Tell me one new product, either in category or a really outstanding design concept that you have seen in the past 5 years. Nobody is going to tell me anything because it really hasn't been done. So, if you're not offering something new, why will that person come to you? So what is the roadmap to success? said, I'm going to address the same points, and how are we going to do this thing? The only way to attain success is if we unite as a community. And this is the main part of the presentation today. I took you through the period of glory and where we still had some hope. I took you through what has happened over the last 8 years, 10 years, and why we are in this situation today. So how are we going to go ahead with it? And for that, the first thing we need to do is remove the alphabets UN from the word unethical. We need to all become very, very ethical in every business practice that we do. And if you are not willing to do this, we might as well say that, okay, let's forget the industry. Maybe by 2020 there are no jewelry buyers, or they only go and buy fashion jewelry, and we all move into fashion jewelry. So if you don't remove the word UN from unethical, there is absolutely no scope for us to grow anywhere. Self-governance is what we should try and adopt. We should not wait for the government to put regulations. Okay? If the government has to start putting regulations, that's a challenge for us. But the minute you start controlling yourself, the minute you start doing things that are right, that challenge is far less. It is minuscule. And therefore, we need self-governance. And how can we do self-governance? Many people won't like the word I'm using, but we all need to be alert and become whistleblowers. Don't tolerate the guy sitting next to you cheating, because at the end of the day, it's going to come back to you. If you know somebody who is cheating, you need to make sure that he stops doing it. Even if it means telling five of you, let it go viral, I don't think you should care about it. Because if he's destroying the whole industry, I don't think any of us sitting here should tolerate that in the slightest. I believe, and you can see, the bite is worse than the bark. I believe it is time for every single organization, whether it's a council, an association, whatever, to make sure that they bite. Just barking is not going to help. In fact, if there are people in the council who do not want to bite, don't elect them to the council. Okay. Because they are the ones who are going to set the tempo for how people and members work. And if they don't have a bite, if they are willing to turn a blind eye and not take action under whatever fear that they may have, then we have a big challenge. Because everybody is finally going to refer to the council or to the association, whether it's a GJF, whether it's a GJEPC, whether it's the Bombay Bullion Association, whatever, if anybody is doing something wrong, any of their members are doing something wrong, I think the council should step up and bite. Barking is not going to work. Okay? And don't let the industry members do it. Speak up. And if you don't do this, and we can already see, people are talking about the future of the industry. I am constantly asked wherever I go, what is your opinion about the future of the industry? I am sitting having coffee at the table, and the next coffee I can hear four people talking about the future of the industry. Okay? So if we are worried about the future of the industry, if we are worried where we are going from today, and we are not willing to take any action, whether on ourselves, self-governance, whether on our neighbors, we come up with some door, or making sure that our councils and associations are empowered and have the right people who want to tackle this issue. If you're not willing to do these things, nothing works. If you're not willing to help yourself, trust me, there is nobody in this world who is going to help you. We keep saying that they should reduce the rough prices. Okay? Is that really a solution? Why don't I talk of increasing my margins? And if we think that they're doing something wrong, why are we going on buying rough? It just doesn't make sense. Okay, people are realizing it now. Last month, I think 70% of DPA's rough was not picked up by the site holders. I think it's a great step. But at the same time, we need to be rational about what we are doing. If you're in a bathroom having a shower, the water is flowing very well, suddenly the shower outlet gets choked, what are you going to do about it? Are you going to stop the inflow of water and sit down? You'll never have a shower. Okay, the pipe may not burst because there is no more water coming in, but you'll never have your shower. You have to clean that end. And this is what I'm talking of, even when you buy rough. Sometime back, there was a proposal within the industry that for 2 months people would stop import of rough. Is that a solution? Your solution is at the other end of the pipeline that consumers are not buying. Why don't you address that? Then your flow will continue. We've been thriving for the last 10 years. Everybody is talking about great shows. They are all B2B. How many great B2C shows have you heard of? I have not heard of any. So you are focusing on something that you want to recycle within yourself, and then you want to show profits. A jeweler can show profits very easily even if he doesn't sell a single piece, not anymore, but 10 years back definitely. Even if he did not sell a single piece in his shop the whole year, the value of gold has gone up at the end of the year by 10%, the value of diamonds has gone up by 15%, so the jeweler's inventory has risen by 12%, and therefore he has a profit of 12% on the books. He has not sold a single piece of jewelry. Is that business? No, but that's how we've been conducting our business. And is that the right way to do it? Well, I think the answer is up to you. You see what situation we are in today. And if this is the situation we want to be in, then it's the right thing to do. But if that's not what we want, we need to correct. And we need to take big corrective action. And it has to start with everybody. Everybody sitting in this room, everybody who's on the floor down there. If everybody doesn't do it, it's not going to work. Financial integrity. Focus on the business. It is profitable. Trust me, it is profitable. But focus on it. More often than not, what I see, and the worst part, it is mainly the biggies who do it, who control maybe 60 or 70% of the business. They are in the business only to use the business as a source of funds. They will show exports, take the money, put it into real estate, put it into some hedge fund, put it into some stock market, put it wherever they think they will make money. And then when that goes, I know people here who tell me, "Arre, defaulter ho gaya toh kya hai?" I have heard it. I have seen a balance sheet once with one of the companies where they had not included the bank amount at all in the balance sheet. Very seriously. It was a kacha balance sheet for internal use, but that's how they're thinking. That means they don't have a challenge with becoming a willful defaulter. Otherwise, why the hell would you ever prepare a balance sheet where your bank outstandings are not shown? It's ridiculous. And if you want this industry to survive, these kind of things cannot be tolerated. And at the end of the day, we are here to do a business. We are not here to gamble. When you take funds from the business, which has been given to you for the business, which is supposed to be used for your business, and you use those funds and divert them somewhere else in the hope of making a short-term profit, there is absolutely no justification for that. Absolutely none. Because the money that was supposed to grow your industry is now not growing it. It is detrimental. And I've heard from very reliable sources that people actually sell diamonds below their cost only so that they can take money from the bank. Where are we going with all this? We need to wake up. We need to take action. This industry is a good industry. This industry has made money in the past. It will continue to make money in the future, provided the players are serious about the business. If your only aim of being in the industry is to get cash rich today and not care about the future of this industry, then what we are doing is perfectly correct. But if you're serious about the business, if this is the business that you want to be in, if you want to make sure that this business thrives, we need these corrections very, very fast. I already talked about this. You need to market to the millennials and Generation Z. Okay? They are the ones of the future. Your baby boomers will exist maybe for the next 10 years. Okay? Most baby boomers on an average today are about 60 years old, I would think. So it will continue for the next 10 years. Whom are you going to sell to after 10 years if you don't start targeting the millennials? And whom will you sell after 20 years if you don't start targeting the Generation Z? Generation Z is people who are in their 15 to 20 years of age today. They are your potential buyers. You need to make sure that they are addressed. When I started, I mentioned that some of you may have seen my presentation called Shift Happens. And I could see very few heads nodding. Why is that? Because they'd seen Shift Happens 8 years back. And therefore, they still remember it after 8 years. But people who are younger in the industry, who came into the industry after 2006, don't know about it. That's the same with your advertising. People who came in after DTC stopped advertising, they are not going to know about you. And they are not going to come and buy your product. So it's very simple. Advertising is a must. And most people tell me that advertising is an unnecessary cost. Okay? I used to hear that statement when I started the first jewelry factory 25 years back. That design is an unnecessary cost. But trust me, that's not true. We have all experienced it over the last 20 years, so we know it is not true. And although at one time Italy was also a prime manufacturer, and it is not so today, I think we will all agree that Italian designs are still what is keeping that industry solvent. You cannot ignore these aspects. And advertising is never an expense. It is an investment. It is an investment for the consumer to know about your product, for the consumer to come and buy it. And trust me, at the end of the day, advertising and that desire that you create in the consumer will give you higher margins. Advertising is never going to make your product cheaper. It will only make your product better, more desirable, and therefore for you, healthier margins. So advertising is not something you can ever ignore. And look at today's world. Look at the way the world has changed. Today you can reach millions of customers via the internet, via all the different social media platforms, at probably 1/100th of the cost it would take you to reach that kind of a consumer base 10 years back. I mean, if you look at what does a, I don't know if anybody has numbers, but what does a 10 second slot on a TV cost? Probably 3 lakhs. In 3 lakhs, you can do all social media platforms for the whole year and continuously upgrade your image. There you will have to shoot a new film every time if you want to change. Here, all you have to do is to click a photograph, make some and post it. You can put a new one every day if you want, and yet it won't cost you 3 lakhs of rupees a year. That's what we are talking of. Change with times, but you cannot ignore being in front of the customer's eyes. You need to be there all the time. You need to make sure that people are seeing you all the time. Okay? And of course, innovate, even as far as advertising is concerned. Innovation can be done everywhere. I mean, unfortunately, the maximum innovation we have done is probably in financial manipulation. Okay? That's why we are in the situation that we are in today. So financial manipulation, all kinds. If we had used that same innovation and creative ideas in creating product, in marketing and everything else, you probably wouldn't be here and listening to me crib about what we did wrong. You'd probably all be down there selling and making sure that more and more goods are sold and what you can hear from your customers so that you can innovate your next line. That's what it's all about. Now, every time I talk of advertising, everybody says funds is a big challenge. And I have seen it myself. I have had the pleasure of working with the council actively for I think good about 10, 12 years. And at one stage, I think it was about 4 years back that we started Anant. And the whole idea of Anant was to do generic advertising and promote jewelry as a category. Okay, unfortunately, we had to shut it down in about a year only because of financial constraints. It's a catch-22 situation, really. When the going is good and you ask somebody to advertise, he says, "Arey, dhanda bahut achha hai. Why do I need to advertise?" And when the going is bad and you ask somebody to advertise, "Arey, there is no sales, there is no margin. Where will I take out money from advertising?" Either way, we are the loser. Normally what everybody tries to find is a win-win solution. Here we always have a lose-lose solution. And therefore Anand tapered off. I know today there are plenty of people who must be telling Sanjay Bhai, who keep telling me, why don't you start Anand again? But again the question is, how is it going to be funded? You need money. If DTC was spending $100 million a year, that is some solid money that we are talking of. Okay? And if we don't have the money, how are you going to do it? So my take on this is that anybody who doesn't have the money to advertise does not have a right to be a part of the industry. Okay? And therefore what I'm suggesting is the introduction of what I'm just calling for the time being an industry survival fund. Right now the advertisement is not only about advertising, it is a question of survival for all of us. And therefore I'm calling it an industry survival fund. Every organization, council, association has to participate in it. You can make this into a global this thing. And what am I asking for? It's not a big amount. I am asking that every member has to contribute 0.1% of whatever he sells to that fund. Okay? And so that it is not an additional burden for him. I would believe that 0.1% on sales everybody should be able to afford. But even if they find that too much, I am saying that if you have purchased from another contributing member, I will offset that amount for you. Okay? So you will get credit at 0.1% on all purchases that you make from somebody who is contributing. It's pretty much like your tax offset. Okay, this is not rocket science. I'm just taking the tax structure and putting it here. And at a ridiculous rate of 0.1%. But you will see that that gives us enough money to do serious advertising. Okay? In effect, one is paying 0.1. Sorry, that's a typo. In effect, one is paying 0.1% of their value addition. Okay, so I am assuming that you are always dealing with a registered member and therefore your sales minus purchase is what you will pay on. So you are going to pay 0.1%, that's a typo, don't look at it as 1%. No, it's 0.1%. I am asking you to pay 0.1% on sales and I am giving you credit for 0.1% on purchase. So you are paying 0.1% on value addition. Sales minus purchase is your value addition. It's a typo. Okay? And this is for local as well as export sales. Anybody who wants to be in the industry, anybody who wants to participate in the industry, has to come under this scheme. And all members, all councils, all associations should give some kind of a certificate and make sure that that certificate is publicized at the consumer level and their advertising, saying, look for this mark when you buy. Okay? I'm not guaranteeing diamond quality. I'm not guaranteeing anything except that that person is an active and contributing member of the industry. Okay? Members are given a recognition of mark as members of this fund. Not difficult to execute. And look at the kind of money it will get us. India's exports are approximately $30 billion. Correct me if I'm wrong, please. And that's 180,000 crores of rupees. The local retail business is 200,000 crores of rupees. Now what I mean by retail business is that if I as a manufacturer sell to the retailer, my sale is not included in the 200,000. But when the retailer sells, that is included. Okay? So if I buy polished diamonds for, I'm a jewelry manufacturer, I buy polished diamonds from somebody, okay? He is paying 0.1% on his sales. I am paying 0.1% on my diamond markup, gold and labor. And I am selling to the retailer. And the retailer is marking it up by, say, 50%. So that 50%, he will pay 0.1%. Okay? Just like that, precisely. And this can get us a 380 crore annual budget for advertising. Can you imagine what your industry would be if you had that kind of budget? And if anybody is saying that he cannot afford 0.1%, I'm telling you, don't take him as a member, tell him to get out of the trade. He does not deserve to be a part of the trade. Because if somebody cannot afford 0.1% of value addition to contribute to making sure that the trade thrives, okay, I'm calling it survival fund, but we should be thriving once we do this. if we are not capable of contributing 0.1% of my value addition to make sure that the trade thrives, what right do I have to be in this industry? And people have to pay. All exporters cannot export without a GJEPC membership. Is that correct?
No more?
Okay. But I'm sure they get benefits. They get to participate in a show. They get to participate in the shows abroad under the GJEPC banner. There are advantages. Make sure that those advantages go to people who are serious about the business. Not people who are just coming around and fooling around and doing all the hanky-panky and then leaving the trade to suffer. That's not what we are here for. That's not what we are looking at. So you need to create something like this. I think what you should do is get all associations together to make sure that something like this seriously happens. And Sanjay, I would request you to take the initiative, and all the press, whoever is here, should support this, should spread this message. If we do not do the things that I'm talking of, I do not see a very bright future. I do not see a light at the end of the tunnel. And if we want to continue in this business, if we want this business to survive and thrive, these are essential elements that you need to take on. It's not only about advertising, it's also about being ethical, it's also about self-control, it's also about, I put that picture of a community watch. That's what we need to become. If tomorrow you're staying on some road and there are robberies happening every day, you're going to form a community watch and say, okay, two people, one at that, and you stay awake for 2 hours, I'll stay awake for 2 hours, you're going to do something about it. So why not this? This is also your road, this is also your business. You need to take care of it. Know and understand your target audience. Develop product for the targeted consumer. There are so many innovations one can do. It is mind-boggling. It's just that we don't do it. And why we don't do it? Because we, especially as India, it's not that we are the cheapest manufacturers in the world. It's just that we work with the lowest margins in the world. Most people don't account for designing, don't account for services that they have to offer post-sale to the consumer as a very serious factor in the costing. I don't know of any Thai manufacturer or even a Chinese manufacturer today who will work below that stipulated margin. We Indians will tend to kam milta hai le lo. We have never learned to say no. We'll always say yes. We may not deliver after that, but we'll say yes. And that's a challenge. So, innovate in everything. Product, display, services. And if you want to change this situation, we need to change our mindset. The only thing that is stopping us from doing anything is our mindset. Everybody I meet constantly today, the only complaint is that the miners are not reducing their rough price. Everybody. And I met a gold guy yesterday who gave me a very good interpretation. I asked him, I said, how is the business? He said, I'm sold out. So I said, great, when is the party? He's saying, October. I said, why? He's saying, I'm sold out. Nobody has given me a single price advance. Some people have already told me that they will take delivery in October. And the way things are going, by October, if the price of gold is down by another 4%, I have no problem. I don't know the gold business, but this is what I'm told by somebody who sells gold. And literally he's shut down his booth, saying that everything I have is already sold. That's the way we want to do business, then we might as well live. Then you don't have a right to complain.
Gold guys are selling, all diamond guys should enter into gold
market. Okay. What is this? Okay, so this is the situation, and I can't emphasize more than what I'm already doing, that if we do not change, if we do not initiate right now, there is no future, and we have no right to complain then. Then do not complain that the industry is not doing well, that this is the case, this guy is not paying my money, whatever be the case. You have no right to complain. We are today in a situation where we probably have much more manufacturing than the actual demand. Okay? But then if that's the case, and you know how much you can sell, you should be buying that much less rough. Then you say that that guy is, the minute you buy less rough and the miner also realizes that the business is in a challenge, he might take corrective action. Or he may not. But that's a second point. The first point is, do we do what is right for our business or not? And that is what it's all about. This entire presentation is actually about doing what is right. And why have we called it thriving through unity? For the simple reason that till you are united, this is not a one-man show. If one person says, I want to do this, it is never going to happen. It has to be through a community change. It has to be through the change in the whole gem and jewelry family. And only then can that happen. So, we need to think about it, we need to change our mindset, and we need to make sure that things happen. That's it. I think if you have any questions, I'd be more than willing to answer them. Yes.